IPv6 security in particular. I have been doing that for about, say, over 10 years. I've done a lot of work on that. It has had to do with analyzing implementations, analyzing specifications, producing tools, producing standards, and so on. It's not that you just discover flaws or vulnerabilities, but in a way you help to actually improve the state of affairs. I like it protocols, so I would study protocols, try to, for example, improve performance, change things, and I ended up working in security as a side effect. What I tried to do essentially is to cover most of the important security aspects of IPv6, and I tried to produce background on why things are the way they are, like, you know, why the protocol was designed in the way it was designed, and also explain, well, what are the security implications, how you can exploit those security implications, and how things have evolved in the last few years, what things have been improved, what things have been patched, and so on. The only benefit is it has more addresses, that's it. And when it comes to security, I would say that it's actually less secure. Not necessarily because of the protocol itself, but, you know, what you find is that, for example, the people that work with protocols, they have less knowledge about IPv6. So obviously, the less you know something, the worse it is to defend a network that uses that, you know, that protocol or technology. In the 90s, for example, the IPv4 implementations were, like, very immature. Like, there were lots of flaws, problems, you know, denial of service attacks, and so on. Well, to some extent, that has been the case of IPv6 implementations recently. It has improved over time, but certainly, you know, V6 implementations are not as mature as their before counterparts. My goal is, it's something like, okay, let's find all the possible problems now. Let's try to improve the protocol as soon as possible, so that by the time most networks deploy IPv6, it's in a much better shape than right now. Most of the, let's say, vulnerabilities that you discover are denial of service vulnerabilities. In many cases, yeah, they can crash the system. There have been many, many cases like that. I would say that maybe the impact nowadays is not that bad in many cases because of the deployment level of IPv6. It's, you know, it's not so widely deployed. Unfortunately, what happens is that, you know, many vendors don't take V6 security seriously, and many ISPs either. So there have been many cases in which I found problems and I was talking to ISPs or vendors and saying, well, like, what do you do about this? Like, you know, what are the mitigations? And they are not even aware about the problem. They are not mitigating anything. So it's kind of like scary from that point of view, that in many cases you have ISPs that get to deploy IPv6 without any clue about the security implications. One of the big problems with that is that in many cases, even for example, ISPs that deploy IPv6, they don't have visibility, meaning that maybe IPv6 is being actively employed for something bad, like, you know, whether that's denial of service or to perform other kinds of attacks. It's not nice if you know that it's being actively employed for malicious purposes, but it's even worse if you're clueless, like if you have no idea what's going on. And that's actually the case in many cases. No, people were assuming that for IoT, you have to have, like, everything directly connected to a network. There's even people that say, well, if we want to have the smart grid, we need V6 addresses. Well, if you really think about it nowadays, most of the IoT devices that you have right now, they don't even support IPv6. Now, if you connect these devices directly to the network, well, they are going to be hacked very badly. In an ideal world, you'd want to have good IoT devices, but you don't have that. So at the end of the day, it's not such a bad idea to have the IoT devices behind a NAT or firewall or something that at least filters some of the packets and let's say reduces the exposure of these devices to the public internet. I have, like, examples, like, you know, I was, for example, discovering some denial of service that you could DOS a device just with a single packet. So I was contacting, like, you know, ISPs that I had contacts with, and I asked it, like, well, are you doing anything about it? And they were clueless. I mean, in a sense, it's understandable too, because, you know, one of the problems behind IPv6 is that essentially you have this protocol that changes in so many different ways all the details to do exactly the same thing. So you have people that have been working for 20, 30 years with IPv4, and now they have to change things completely in a different way to do exactly the same thing. And that kind of like doesn't work quite well with people. Curiously enough, there's not that many people working or like, you know, producing knowledge when it comes to, you know, IPv6 security. For example, when you look at toolkits, there are like 2, 3, 4, 5 toolkits, and not that many for a technology that is such a core technology for the internet. Not that many people also doing improvements when it comes to the standards. I mean, I've done quite a lot of that work, and there's not that many other people doing that.